Members sing the national anthem.
What so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, stay, can that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Thank you. And for those who know it, American one, now I can't think of the
God save our gracious Queen, long live our noble Queen, God save the Queen, send her victorious, happy and glorious, long to reign over us, God save our Queen.
Thank you.
Costume Guild, as you may have seen them running around with their fantastic hats, putting us all to shame with the rest of our outfits. And we're going to be introducing them and giving a little brief summary of what they're wearing.
I need to send for the magistrate gaming.
Cleaned his wheels up and he's
No, no, I'm not.
So, first off, this is a costume of Professor Abraham Van Helsing, popularly known as Dr. Van Helsing. He's a character from the 1897 Gothic horror novel Dracula, which was written by a British man named Bram Stoker, who was born in Dublin in 1847 and died in London in 1912. Van Helsing is an aged Dutch doctor with a wide range of interests and accomplishments. The character is best known as a vampire hunter and the archenemy of Count Dracula. Woo!
I don't think they had that coming.
So up next, this is Lisa Root presenting The Mad Hatter and the Cheshire Cat from Alice in Wonderland by Lewis Carroll, an English author of the 1800s. The Mad Hatter loves his tea. He was mad due to the chemical elements required in the hat-making process. So now he spends his time enjoying his tea in the company of his friends. She made the jacket and the hat and designed the cat on the hat. Lewis Carroll didn't indicate the color of the Cheshire Cat, so she took artistic license. The hat slash cat were created for this year's San Diego County Fair. The theme was steampunk and Alice in Wonderland.
Yay. Excellent.
Wow.
Oh,
lady.
So, here we have a costume of Dame Barbara Cartland. She was the grandmother by marriage to Princess Diana. She was billed as the Queen of Romance. She wrote over 700 novels that sold over a billion copies worldwide, making her one of the most prolific and commercially successful writers of the 20th century, and earning her a place in the Guinness Book of Records. In time, she became one of the UK's most popular media personalities, invariably a confection in pink, refusing to moderate her liberal use of cosmetics, arriving in a flurry of glamour and glittering jewels, overdressed for any occasion. Ever ready with a memorable soundbite, she once said of her preference for men that she would rather have lunch with a stupid man than a clever woman. No mere figure of fun, she provided dresses for wartime brides, sang an album of love songs with the Royal Philharmonic, was recipient of a myriad of humanitarian awards, a true champion of unlikely causes from gypsies to midwives. In 1981, she became a Dame of the Order of the British Empire for contributions to literature and her work for the community. At home, her beloved Camfield Place, former home of Beatrix Potter, was decorated in pink. It was there she reclined on a chaise lounge to dictate her work and dine every evening in full formal dinner regalia. At times, she wrote 25 books a year, the last at age 97. All had handsome heroes and blonde heroines who fell into each other's arms for the happiest of endings. Dame Barbara Cartland passed away in 2000, just before her 99th birthday.
This is Margaret Hager. The Duchess is a character in Lewis Carroll's Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, published in 1865. The Duchess lives in Wonderland in a small palace outside the caterpillar's forest. She employs a frog footman who enjoys staring at the sky for days on end, oblivious to most people in or out of the house. She also employs a cook who is addicted to pepper and who throws crockery and kitchen utensils all over her shoulder with no concern for those who might be hit. The Duchess has a child who is constantly sneezing from the pepper. When Alice fears for the baby's safety, she removes the baby from the Duchess's home. Before Alice arrives at the Mad Hatter's tea party, the baby has transformed into a piglet. Of the Duchess's household, her cat, the original owner of the Cheshire Cat, appears to be by far the most balanced and sensible, although it is quite mad. The Duchess is an antagonist of the Queen of Hearts. In her first appearance, the Duchess seems nearly as unpleasant as the Queen herself, but later on treats Alice with friendliness and respect. The inspiration for the Duchess is Queen Victoria's mother, the Duchess of Kent. And that concludes the procession of the costumes. Thank you.
Another character.
And this is a British built penny farthing, the bicycle of the late 1800s, Britain and France manufactured. And the name of the bike comes from the two coins in Britain, the penny being this big and the farthing being 1/4 the size. And I represent SoCal penny farthing in San Diego. Whenever you see me writing, just yell Rick. Thank you.
Hello, so you just saw the lovely penny farthing, and our next presentation will be at 1:45. The Chivalry Today group will be doing a deed of arms presentation in full armor.
Historical techniques of combat. So we're going to start with unarmored combat with a two-handed sword. Now, this is based on 14th century fight books, so the techniques being used here are drawn and taught from historical documents. In fact, there were separate techniques, not surprisingly, taught for unarmored combat done in blouse fechten or street shirts, linen shirts, versus armored. And in a few minutes, we'll also be doing some techniques in full armor, and you'll notice they're fairly different. Because you can do movements, as Adam just demonstrated. Show me a couple of Zwerchows, up to Ox and Zwerchow, both of you. Yeah, watch their wrists. You can't cross your wrists like that in armor. It can't be done. So you'll notice that some of the techniques that we will be using for the unarmored are quite different. This was taught for the same reasons we do it today. It was learned for self-defense. It was learned because it's a lot of fun. It was learned for getting exercise. Women, some women, noble women, did learn it. And it was done in tournaments. Now, there's a huge myth a lot of people have going that the focus of a tournament was to kill your opponent. Nothing could be further from the truth. That's called murder. So, in fact, tournaments were, as they are today, generally, they were most commonly a sporting event of competition. So you will notice that they are fighting with untipped steel swords. These are not sharp any more than they would have been sharp in a tournament. The point is not to kill your opponent. However, that's not a very wide edge. So let me tell you from experience, if the person you're sparring with is not using control, you can do some serious damage with that edge, especially that point. It'll slide right in. So we are big on control. That does not mean that we are not capable of using techniques. We are using techniques that with more power would do damage. We simply choose to use the correct techniques and not damage our friends. So, gentlemen, stand you ready?
Aye.
This fight will be to 3 points. My apologies, gentlemen. I forgot to tell them what they're looking at. What will happen is the first person who receives 3 strikes, one of which is to either the head or the body, showing greater skill to get into head, neck, body. First person to receive those 3, including one to head, neck, body, loses. Kind of like a video game. Okay? All right. So, and the fighters will call their own shots.
All right. Are we going to pause and
bring it, or are we going to keep going? Let's just keep going. So I will try to just yell good. I'll try to keep track. Okay, so they are going to continue fighting. They'll yell good when it's good. I will try to keep track. Okay, gentlemen, stand your head. Lay on. One. Two, one each. Notice there's a lot of work at what's called the bind. There's none of the Hollywood smack, smack, smack. You do not want to have your sword away from your opponent, because if your sword is away from your opponents, you are not being guarded. Two. Nice call. I don't know if you saw that, but Adam got Harvey on the wrist. A nice cut, and it was a definite cut. It wasn't just a nick. We tend not to call nicks incidental on the hands, but if there's a deliberate cut, it would have cut through because they would have been sharp swords. You also notice there's fighting going on here. Ah! And there's a fair amount of grappling. Okay, so who got that one? That looked like a tie.
I don't know. Who was that?
Okay. So, two on Adam, because he won the grappling match, I believe, but Harvey acknowledged that he got pommeled in the head. You may have not seen that, but Adam pommeled him in the head. So, that makes victory to that particular bout to Adam. Nicely fought, gentlemen. So, I'm going to step in and fight with Adam, and Harvey is going to take over moderating.
Good afternoon, folks. Thanks for coming. Yes, although it doesn't look that hard, it is quite a fatiguing activity. April's putting on now what's called a gorget to defend her neck from a thrust upwards to the throat, which is one of the things we have to worry about with these steel swords. We're wearing what are called gorgets. We're also wearing protective masks today, although we often spar without them, just in case, because these steel swords do flash around and we don't want to catch each other in the face. And we're wearing padded gloves, and April is ready. So, three hits, fighters, keep track of your own hits. If you want to shout them out, that would be helpful, but don't stop. Okay, so...
Okay, so when I stop, just yell, don't stop.
I will. So, for honor and chivalry, fighters acknowledge each other and lay on. Blood. Keep going.
Two.
Yep.
Three.
Yes. Nicely done, Adam. So three hits were struck on April. She acknowledged them all. One hit on Adam. So Adam wins that round. I think you guys should take a break and go again. All right? So that was short. Adam really got in three quick hits. We're just warming up here. So, you guys, for honor and chivalry, acknowledge each other and lay on. A hit to Adam's arm. He's all right. He's not wearing armor under that white... Two hits. Under that white cotton shirt. Whereas April and I are wearing gambesons, which are these padded jackets to protect the arms. Another hit to Adam's face, and April acknowledges a hit to her hand. So we're now 2-1. 3-2? Yeah, so quickly. Okay, so the second round went to
April.
So let's have a decider. Come on, let's keep it going, folks. So, acknowledge each other, and lay on. The essence of this technique is to use leverage, that is to get that strong part of your sword against the weak point of your opponents and control it. That's what they're trying to do when they come to what's called a bind, which is both swords in contact. So at this point, oh, nice, right there on Adam's head. Okay, on again. Three hits on Adam, and that concludes the fight, and April wins 2-1. Thank you, folks.
So yes, that's actually a little more aerobic than you might think, because you're constantly trying to feel at that bind. Generally, this is not about velocity the way modern fencing tends to be. These are heavier weapons. They're about, as Harvey said, they're about leverage. So generally, the first person, when you come to that cross where your swords are crossed, the first person to make the correct leverage move is likely to win. It's not about getting there fast. It's not about getting there strong. Because if you come too strong to the bind, there's answers to that. And that's why me, who is older than everybody else here, and female, still has a chance. Because this is very much a game of skill and technique and a willingness to master the technique. So we've got our armored fighters showing up here. Now, this is 14th century, late 14th century armor. Actually, Aaron is in, come on out, Aaron. This is coat of plates. This could have been early 14th century all the way into the early 15th century. You notice that, for example, Patrick, come out here and be pretty for us for a minute. So Patrick is a later, it's going to be, this is more early 15th century. Notice that with Aaron, he wandered off, he's pretty too. With Aaron, what's happened is he has a classic leather with plates underneath it, okay? Coat of plates. Patrick also has a coat of plates, but notice that he has layered pieces, the pieces are larger. That's a little bit more metallurgy. It's very likely that his lord, or if he is the owner, that he is a knight, didn't perhaps have quite as much money as his lord did, or it was a little bit later. Okay, who's fighting first?
I assume I am.
Yeah, okay, I'm ready. Looks like David's ready. Okay, so we have David is also, he's over here in the brown armor. They are both wearing bassinets with closed-faced helms. Just as they did in the Middle Ages in tournaments, Harvey, do you know our swords? Or are you guys doing poleaxes or swords? Oh. So, these gentlemen, because they're in armor, are going to be hitting full power. And they are using historical techniques. So, if you are using true historical techniques and hitting full power, you do what they did in the Middle Ages in tournaments, which is you use what's called a waster. Now, their wasters were typically made of wood, basically a wooden sword of the same weight and length and mechanics. We use nylon because, frankly, wood shatters and these are tougher. It is pretty much the same flexibility, the same weight, the same length. They will be hitting hard. So, you need that armor. Now, if you watch their fighting, what you're gonna see is you're not gonna see a whole lot of that. Because hitting people in the armor doesn't do any good. That's what armor's there for. So in fact, hitting people in the head, if you hit them hard enough in the head, you'll stun them and it'll be acknowledged. Now, you'll get hit in the head. That might or might not count. You don't need to hit him in the head right now. He'll get it, see him in the fight. But, go under the arm. There, under the arm, in the elbow, in the neck, in the eye slots, behind the knee, yeah, exactly. Ugh. Those are the ones that are really gonna count, okay? So in the hand, yes, definitely in the hand. So generally, the stranger the technique, shows Mordschlag. Mordschlag, there you go. That's a Mordschlag. Taking the blade in the two hands and using it as a hammer to really stun them. Two hands on the blade. It's called half swording. Very common. It turns your sword into a short spear because that armor is hard to get through. So the stranger the technique, probably the more historical it actually is. Okay, gentlemen.
Ready?
Lay on. Okay. So, disarm. And then because Patrick did not stop fighting, which he is not required to do, David very nicely thrust him in the eye slot. So, one down on Patrick. Okay, so, David was attempting to take Patrick down in a grappling move. Patrick very smart, intelligently stabbed him in the armpit. Yes, while he was trying to do that. So you can tell there's a lot of grappling in period techniques, and that's why if you lose your sword, you don't necessarily end the fight. Okay, one each.
Oh. No. No?
Okay, they said yes, they hit, not hard enough given the armor. And you'll notice who said no is the person throwing the blow. Okay, Patrick said, yep, stab to the throat, absolutely good. So the two on Patrick, one on David, go ahead. So you'll notice that our fighters are the person receiving the blow judges the impact, but the person throwing the blow can say no, it was not good, I don't care what you thought.
What?
Okay, so the Mordschlag to Patrick's side wasn't all that hard, but David said the one to the head certainly was. So now we're two even. Good, where'd you get it? Okay, so David said, yes, Patrick thrust him right below the armor into the hip where there was no protection. So in that case, hard fought fight, victory goes to Patrick. Very nice.
You got a finger cover that.
Okay, so the next fight is going to be between Aaron and Kate. So if any people have questions, you're welcome to ask them. We'll also, afterwards, we'll be around. You're welcome to come up, see the armor, see what it feels like, answer any questions. We're always happy to do that. Another example that if you're brave enough, you can be half the weight of your opponent, because Kate is pretty much about half Aaron's weight, and still fight this game. Okay, fighters, you ready? Lay on. Okay, Aaron got that, I don't know if you saw it, but Aaron got that tip right into Kate's neck. You can see that sword bend. One on Kate. Yeah. Okay, so Kate was in there with that tip, trying to get it. Did she get it under your neck? Okay, so you saw her digging for it. She's got it under his neck. One each. Oh, armor failure. Kate yields because her, not because she dropped the sword, because Aaron disarmed her, but because her gauntlet was coming off. And you absolutely do not do this without hand protection. Good call. Two on Kate, one on Aaron.
Yeah.
Oh.
That was above the ice line.
Oh, okay. So Kate saw a sword coming at her face. Aaron said, in reality, that was a nice call, because really it hit right up here. So that's perfectly a good armor, nice call on Aaron's part. Two on Kate, one on Aaron. Okay, that went right into Kate's neck. Nice fight. Who's up?
I'm dropping.
Scott and who?
You want to take it or shall I?
Okay, Scott's going with Kate.
Yeah.
Oh,
come on
now.
Oh, you'll get your hand. It's nice and cool for us in the shade. These people are each carrying about 50 to 60 pounds of armor. And what they're wearing under most of it is what I'm wearing, which is a fairly heavily padded jacket. So it's rather toasty warm in there. Okay, so, stand, you ready? Lay on. Nope, glanced off. Okay, so Scott was busy trying to get below Kate's breastplate, and in fact she stabbed him in the neck. So, one on Scott. Was that a glance? Good, glance. No good. No point. Keep going. Than is for him. But did you notice that the old myth that people in full, accurate historical armor cannot stand up is crazy? They're down on the ground, they're up, they're wrestling. Good fitting armor, you have to be able to fight in it. Good? Okay?
Good to see you.
Yeah, gotta make sure the cap is over the tip of the thumb. It's too easy to get hit otherwise. Okay. I lost track of the score. I think we're...
You on me? No.
I think it's 1-1.
Okay.
1-1.
We don't know.
We don't know. Fight.
We can't know. We're going to take too many times.
We'll fight with Mark.
We're not doing
it. She's got 1 round. That's what we're doing.
Oh, nice block on Kate's part. He was ready to smash her head.
Really?
No. No, that was a side. That wasn't a tip. No point.
You don't wear padding
anymore? That'll teach you guys to have good defense.
You can still tie. No, no.
Right on the armor. Oh, behind the knee. Okay, Kate called that one good. You notice he took the tip and brought it right behind the knee. So two on Kate, one on Scott. Lay on. Where? Okay. Okay, so Scott called it under his neck. Kate said no, it was on this part of the armor, no point. Two on Kate, one on Scott. Okay, so that makes it three on Kate and two on Scott, which is a victory to Scott. Obviously a very hard-fought bout. Nicely done, folks. I bet they're panting, both of them. Okay, who's up? It looks to me like it's Patrick and Aaron, because they have their helms on.
Maybe I need to get my gauntlets too.
How bad? How much do you really need those anyway?
They are what I make my living with. To be honest,
okay.
It's not going down again, but it's seeing it.
Yes, of course.
It's seeing it right now.
Okay, so now that you've seen a little bit of this, see what you can do about judging this for yourself. So at the end of this fight, I'm going to ask the audience to decide who showed the most skill in the fight. Now that may or may not be the person who wins the most points, because some of the more skillful shots are more difficult, and they may or may not land. So I'm going to ask you guys this time, at the end of this fight, to decide who was the most skillful. So now that you know what you're looking for, keep an eye. This is Aaron. This is Patrick. Leon. Oh! Okay.
Oh, you have your sword. Okay.
Okay. All right, Patrick says he's okay. That was a little more of an accelerated throw than we usually do.
Yep.
Okay, so one on Patrick. We ready? Okay. Good, good on Patrick, too. Okay, one, two on Patrick, one on Aaron.
What was that? Yeah, mine wasn't good.
Okay. Good, gentlemen, lay on.
Very good.
Okay, nice aim. Okay, so that's three on Patrick, one on Aaron. Nice fight, gentlemen. Good fight. Okay, it looks like it's Scott and David.
Yes. I walked right into it.
Okay, so I have to ask you guys a question now. All right, so we have Patrick is here. Aaron's right there. Think about what you saw. Think about the skill. So how many people, just we'll do this by applause, how many people think that Patrick showed the most skill? How many people think Aaron showed the most skill? Okay. So good eyes, guys. Well done. And believe me, notice that there's a lot of wrestling. Now think about the fact that they are wrestling around someone who's naturally about 175, 180 pounds, plus 60 pounds of armor. So when they're out there wrestling at the sword, they're trying to move around 250 or more pounds of armor, which is makes it very aerobic. So this fight between David and Scott is going to be done with pole axes. Now, a pole axe was P-O-L-L, not P-O-L-E. It meant hitting you in the head, the pole. So it has a spike, a hammer for usually used to smash armor, bend it so you can't move, a back or beak, typically used to get behind a leg or a neck and help wrestle somebody to the ground, and it has a cube that often was shod with metal, and if you get that hit, it's going to be very damaging. You'll also notice they do a lot of leverage with these. Okay, gentlemen, lay on. Yeah, good call. Scott felt it in his throat, but again, it came on that plate.
You gotta do hands on the shoulder and take it.
No hit.
Okay.
Pat, David called it because he felt it. He felt it on the forearm, but that was actually half and not the point. No point. 0-0. Are you calling that? That's on your armor. Okay, so David called the one to his head good, and let me tell you, those things hit like a ton of bricks in your head. I'm sure he felt that. And Scott called the one on his side good because with this amount of damage, he could have done damage through, bent the plate. One each. Yep. He called the good one to the neck. Okay, so two on David, one on Scott. Oh, that one was pretty, and that one went under the plate. Two each. Oh, there you go. Oh. Okay. So, Scott was able to get his back behind David's knee and take him down. You notice David did not go easily and put a knee into Scott's belly as he was going down.
I hope that's three, right?
That is three.
Oh, thank God.
And they're both very glad that that was three, because I say, wrestling with these things is even more energetic than doing the two-handed swords, all in full armor. Okay, it looks like we've got Kate and Patrick.
I don't think so.
Richard, I am entreating your help.
He was saying, lest anybody thinks they really aren't hitting full strength, you might notice that occasionally we dent this armor. And you can tell Kate's breastplate has got dents all over it. And I will tell you, having done this for years before, medical reasons mean I cannot anymore. You can feel it. You can feel it. It's not devastating. That's what the armor is there for. But there's very little question that you got hit. As you can imagine, some of the places we're most concerned with is hands, so the gauntlets are very important. The hands are very, very important. The helm is very important. They have to fit properly, or even with a 12 or 14 gauge helm, if they're not fit properly, the impact of those powerful blows will go through, and we are very concerned about concussion, as you might expect. Ready on? Lay on.
Should we get shots in water?
Okay. Dan, just like,
oh. Nice shot.
That might have been breath play.
No, it was neck. It was neck. One on Kate.
There you go.
One right back. No, 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 it was, no, it was right here. It was in his neck. It missed, no, it. One each. You can see that what Kate's doing here is she's trying to get under that arm.
Good.
Up, right in the neck. Good enough. Two on Patrick, one on Kate. Gotta be pretty. Lay on. So that's two on Patrick, two on Kate. She may have landed on her hand a little hard there, too. Trouble with having somebody that's, you know, 240 pounds going down with you. Okay. Just a second.
My thought is, how about a couple of unarmed in here and let you guys take a breath? Is that good? Where's Scott?
Scott's over on the side.
Okay. So. Since, as you can see, the armored competition is a little aerobic, and our fighters need to make sure everybody's all in one piece and that they are catching their breath, we're going to do another round of unarmored. You might think about the techniques. You've now seen a lot of the techniques for the armored competition, and think about what you're seeing here. Because since this is done in the equivalent of a heavy linen shirt, then the backside cuts.
Sorry.
Yeah. There you go. Nice false edge cuts work very, very well. There is, so the false edge is the backside of the blade. Okay? It's obviously the front and the back are really the same. Here's the true edge. And if you take it, there's the false edge. So really, obviously, in terms of metal, they're the same. We call the true edge as if you were cutting down with an axe, you have the longest reach. The false edge, you cut with the backside. There is a line in one of the fight books that says, watching two people fight with the true edge is watching like watching a man hit rats with a stick. The true artistry is done with the false edge. So watch for interesting cuts, and remember this one, slices, cuts which impact or thrust are all valid blows. Okay, gentlemen, stand you ready? Lay on.
No, it happened yesterday. It wouldn't have been as competitive
if it was yesterday. One on Harvey's hand.
I'm good.
Another on Harvey's, right the back of the neck with the false edge.
Fatal.
So that's what we would call a potentially lethal blow. One, two on Harvey, one on Richard. Oh, none on Richard. Two on Harvey. Can't count. Okay, so one on Richard, two on Harvey. Nice, right in the face. Two each. Nice call. I don't know, that was a really nice call on Harvey because Richard picked him up just with the tip on that back cut. Very nice call. Okay, victory to Richard. Okay, they said they would do one more. Oh, actually, yeah.
Yep. You'll add him in.
Yep.
Okay, so Adam is going to come in and fight Richard.
Something to think about as you're watching the unarmored fighting. You'll notice these guys are wearing a fair amount of clearly modern sports equipment. The fencing masks, elbow pads, whatnot. It gives really the impression that if you were watching this historically, back in the Middle Ages, well, these guys would really be killing each other. But the fact is they practiced martial arts for all the same reasons that we do martial arts today. Certainly for self-defense in battle, but also for enjoyment, recreation, sport, physical fitness. And they would have done this with blunt steel swords, just like we're doing here, without any sort of face protection. And simple control was, when they were fighting in a friendly bout, simple control and trust in your sparring partner was all that kept them from getting stabbed in the face. So we are actually considerably less concerned about safety today than they were back then because we have the modern equipment to protect our face, whereas they simply could not make strikes to the face and had to recognize that when they were looking at an opponent's point, yep, that would have been counted as a good blow in a real fight, then they could have finished the technique.
It also emphasizes why the idea that one should hit hard in competitions doesn't make any historic sense. Okay, gentlemen, you guys ready? Lay on.
I got it.
Did I hear it? One on Richard's arm. Lay on.
And then I win.
Adam? No, go ahead. One each. That was a nice touch to Adam's arm. Second hit on Adam's wrist.
That's right. On the fight.
Third slice across Adam's abdomen. Nicely done. Nicely done.
That was pretty. I know.
So as you can see, again, historic sword fighting has a lot of grappling involved. The first thing they taught was wrestling. And you might also notice that a lot of the leverage is exactly the same between the two-handed sword and the poleaxe. So they taught a fighting system that you could use the fundamentals of, a lot of the same stances and general moves with dagger, with two-handed sword, with poleaxe. It's similar leverage and similar stances and similar moves. Our next fight is going to go back to Armour, and it's going to be between David and Aaron. And I can tell this because Aaron is trying to get his chin strap attached. So fiddling around underneath that nail, trying to get a little thing attached under there, sometimes is really hard to do because you can't exactly see it.
Oh, I love that.
On the gauntlets. Oh, the other thing to notice is we're all wearing period shoes. Okay, so these shoes have no heel and no tread. And that actually turns out to be very important, because if you use modern shoes or boots with heels and treads, you have an unfortunate tendency over the years to ruin your ankles and your knees, because the techniques that they taught were based on the fact that they wore flat leather bottom shoes. So the techniques involve letting your feet twist on the ground. Well, if the tread will not allow your foot to twist, what is going to twist is your ankle or your knee. And if you have a heel or a tread, then instead of being balanced over yourself, you let that tread catch you. That's how you end up rolling an ankle and you never achieve your true balance. On the other hand, you may notice when they get bound up, occasionally one of them will be standing there in a perfect stance and being pushed backwards because they're simply slipping on the ground. But it does turn out to protect your knees and your ankles a lot to use the actual historic foot gear. Okay, gentlemen, you ready?
Ready.
Lay on.
Good.
Ice lot. Nice blow to David's ice lot. Armpit. David got Aaron right in the armpit. Nicely done.
Aren't you so glad you didn't
miss the game? Oh, hell no. Okay. So, one of those got through. It was interesting, and I don't know if you could see it. You could certainly hear it, but everyone until that last one, David's sword was between Aaron's sword and his head. And that's why those earlier ones weren't hitting the way they looked like they were, because I could watch his sword flex as Aaron was trying to get that march log in.
For sure.
So, two on David, one on Aaron.
Yeah.
Okay, three on David. Pommel strike, good hard pommel strike to the head. Enough to take his attention off the fight.
He's your loyal pooch.
Okay, so this time, Scott and Kate are going to do a dagger fight. Now, medieval daggers were not knives.
Do you have daggers?
So a medieval dagger was not a knife. It was more like an ice pick. It's called a rondel. Now, the actual term rondel comes with from the round guards that protected your hand. But you have to imagine that this is a rounded or triangular spike with a very sharp point. It is not a knife. So unlike a modern knife fight, you're not going to see slashing with the edge, because there wasn't a cutting edge. This was a dagger designed to fight in armor, and that means you had to get that point, again, eye slot, neck, in where the plate is not. So you'll see what modern street fighters or knife fighters will say, oh, one should not strike that way. And in a modern fight, that's true. But for historical reasons, if you're fighting with a dagger, you must commit yourself to that strike, or it is not going to go through that nail, because you're going to have to drive that dagger point through that nail. So that takes a lot of power.
Yeah, exactly.
So again, the stranger the position and the stranger the strike, the more likely it is to be correct. So the question was, and it's a good one, so Scott has very pointy elbows. See those little pretty pointy elbows? Were those intended as a weapon? And the answer is no. That's fashion. So that is intended to be intimidating. That is intended to say, I am so wealthy that I can hire an armorer to make very complex curves and points and look very impressive on the fighting field. And by the way, if I were to lose, you should ransom me rather than kill me, because I'm worth a lot of money. So armor was a lot about fashion. See the pretty swoopy, nice little flip at the bottom there? That's pretty much fashion. That heel works equally well, but that pretty little swoop, that's a 15th century fashion statement.
But you'll take it.
I'll take it.
Okay, so again, this is a dagger fight, and so they will call, each of them will call when they feel that that point has gotten to a place where it could get through the chain and could have done real damage. Okay?
Oh, absolutely.
Lamb.
And I was not, it wasn't that hard of a throw. Because like I said, my attention is trying to sit right here.
Right.
So I get on the backside.
Right.
And then whenever you're down.
Okay. He tried for the armpit and missed. Oh, nice. Oh, there we go. All right. It hasn't stopped yet.
No, that was awesome.
Okay, now that is a medieval dagger fight. So, did you notice Scott started the fall, Kate flipped him on the way down, he rolled to the top, she was able to get the point in. So that was that advantage in that little interchange had changed from standing to final thing four times on the way down. I do believe that one ended up with point on Scott. I think he broke a feather.
He broke a feather. About 50 pounds.
Yeah,
61.
Oh, really? Okay.
No, we waited one.
Because of the extra fault.
Oh, sure.
He's got a lot of coverage.
Where?
Yeah,
No, I agree, Kate. Are you saying no? Yeah. So, he felt the thrust, but it was under here. It wasn't the eye slots. No point.
Sit up here.
So, therein lieth the problem with sparring when you get a little intent on your attack and walk. walk into your opponent's point. So, two on Scott. Yep, on the other hand, that was a really beautiful fake, and he just drove the point of his dagger. What would have been, her jugular would have been gone. Two on Scott, one on Kate. Okay, Kate got Scott under the arm. That's victory to Kate. Nice job, both of you. Okay, so let me check out here.
I don't see anybody else with Elmon. She wants more armor. Are you happy? Actually, she just fought. You guys want to fight?
I haven't fought you for
a few minutes.
Okay, so Aaron and Patrick are going to fight this one.
What an amazing thing that happens as soon as I hit the ground for it.
Come on, Benny. Can I say
yeah, please.
His name is Benny. I'll go
with it. This is the nice backup plan.
They bring your dog in if it's not going well. Oh, he saw it. Go ahead. Oh, it's a little Jack.
It's hard to believe that a little jack.
A little easier to figure Benny did.
Yeah.
Are
you okay? You have water? Drink water.
Oh, yeah?
I didn't, you know what? I didn't see him at all in the dark. I had no idea.
Does anyone have any questions at this point while we're waiting for our guys to
go down again?
He's a
Yes, of course.
My name is Benny. He's in a heated town.
Oh my god, he's way better than the ones I've seen.
He's the docent now.
So the very good question about sort of what was the style of the fighting. You had squires fighting before you meet up the main event. The answer is it completely depends on the style of combat. So there was a deed of arms. Typically would have been a chance to showcase a lot of the what they called household knights who were looking to gain prowess. They would have probably not had a list field. They would have simply been out in front of the crowd. They would have fought. There might have been some team fights. What you don't see is the sort of modern tournament, I win, move on to the next bout. It's just all for show.
Yeah.
If it were what was called a pas de armes, then there's much more pageantry. You would have had the night before a big feast. You would have had perhaps several what called a horde with the squires fighting. Then you could have had a few demonstration fights between the really big ones. Much more pageantry. Kind of depends. There was lots and lots of differences. But they were very much into pageantry. This was a demonstration of prowess. The ladies were often the judges. This was their chance to prove to the ladies that they had great prowess and they were chivalrous. This was their chance to shine, and most of the time, women were the judges. Women were the ones who gave out the prizes. So medieval women knew as much about the fighting conventions and that culture as the men did because they lived in the same culture. Good question. Okay, gentlemen.
Yes.
Leon.
Minor? Combination military padding.
Okay. Good shot. Accuracy is very useful.
Yeah, I cheat. Like crazy.
Really? Because there's not been a play. It's like they're testing the boundaries.
Okay, so in all the midst of that, Patrick got his point into Aaron's armpit. One each.
I'm
asking
because I did not
see where it landed. Okay, Patrick yields. Two on Patrick, one on Aaron.
It's nice to be big, isn't it?
Like it helps.
Yeah. Because it's almost like rugby or something. Like
it's not a requirement. A small person can absolutely be huge. Probably the best fighter on the field is him.
Three on the head. That could rock your head. Did everybody see that sword flex? Yeah, right into the throat. Okay. That deserves a hug. That was an awesome shot. Okay, you guys ready? Okay, so Harvey and Adam are going to fight, and then Richard's going to step in. So again, take the chance to watch the difference between the techniques. Technique matters just as much in both cases, but you can imagine that when you're doing unarmored, you have to be much more aware of your defense because all of you is a target. You are not wearing a shield. And so the key to fighting with a two-handed longsword is to never forget that the only thing protecting you from your opponent's sword is your sword. So if you get focused on the attack, then what will happen is you will also get hit. And both of you getting hit is neither of you winning. Okay, gentlemen, stand you ready? Lay on.
Like they were saying, the pointed elbow. That's the bird.
That's fantastic.
And you also see in interior, you see a lot of.
Strike on Harvey!
They're absolutely beautifully colored. Actually, it's going to be rare to do armor and
Strike on Adam! Nice slice! Nice thrust on Harvey! And Adam's intestines fall on the ground. Two strikes each. Oh, okay. So first Adam got hit in the arm, then his intestines fell on the ground. Two on each.
This is a warner.
And a thrust into Harvey's face. Victory to Adam. Nicely fought, gentlemen. Richard's going to step in and fight somebody. Maybe
that should be another.
Okay, so Richard and Adam, are you ready? Lay on.
That makes one of us.
It makes sense. Yeah, it makes sense. I'm relatively. Oh,
you're like my strike on Richard's hand.
Yeah. One. That.
Strike on Adam's hand and Richard, where was that? You called him good. Okay, so a strike to the mask. So, classic case, Adam got his strike into the mask, but he lost his hand doing it. Okay, so two on Richard, one on Adam.
That would be good.
This girl, like, the second I met her. Yeah.
I'm trying to build up. This is all of them.
But that's what I'm trying to do.
Two on Richard. Two on Adam, two on Richard. Oh, I'm sorry, you guys switched around. So that is three on Richard and one on Adam. Victory to Adam. That's what happens when they spin around. I lost track of who was who. Nicely done, gentlemen. Nicely done. Sure. Harvey's gonna take on Richard and then we'll have another Armour. Okay, gentlemen, stand you ready?
I thought I could get away with just the ACH plates, but military panic. But it leaves a gap.
Where?
Oh. And there. Yeah.
Richard's hand? Okay, and Harvey's shoulder.
What do you want to do?
2 seconds. 1 minute. 2 minute.
Nice move on Harvey's part. Slice Richard's leg right open. Okay, so two on Richard, one on Harvey.
Nope, that is the wrong one.
So, well, Richard almost got that one in.
To be honest, I wasn't aware. I assumed this would not have been quite good.
Three on Richard, victory to Harvey. Nice fight, gentlemen. Nice skill.
Okay, thank you.
Very nice, gentlemen.
Right, right.
So we've got Scott and David, because they have their faceplates down. I don't know.
Hold on.
Scott's standing here.
No. You can stand. I'll take both.
There seems to be a discussion of who's fighting whom.
Let them fight it out to see who goes.
They'll have to fight it out to figure out who's supposed to fight who, right?
So yeah, I'm trying to get into it.
I'll do him, and then
I'll do my fight.
Yes, but I'll fight both of you, one at a time. Not both at the same time. I like living. No, I like living.
I'm gonna fight David. You're gonna fight David.
You guys have told me this.
I'm gonna fight that.
I'm
gonna fight David. You're gonna fight that. Then I'm gonna fight that.
I can hear,
despite
there being
room.
Come on, can I borrow?
What do you need?
What are you looking for there? Sword?
Yeah,
another gold. So at this point, the fighters are pretty much just having fun, because that's what they like to do is fight. So if there are questions even during the fight, feel free to ask, and I will be happy to try to answer them as soon as he quits coughing. Okay, gentlemen, lay on. Right, nice shot right into David's armpit. One on David.
I know, right? Definitely regretting it a little bit.
Being a good German is lazy. I like long term.
Right in the face.
I didn't do a plan.
Oh, wait, okay.
Yep, Scott said, oh yeah, that landed right in my face. Okay, one each.
Good.
Right in the armpit. Two on Scott, one on David. They're calling both of those good. Oh, whoops. Yeah, there's the problem. Thank you. Oopsie. We brought an extra one. Good thing. Okay, now I've lost track. Yeah? Okay. I think it's 2-2. So, in fact, that broke, and people might think, well, it broke because it's plastic. No, actually, in the Middle Ages, swords broke all the time, which is a problem because they're expensive. Okay. Finger to Scott. The problem with swords are that they have a small tang, and so when you are hitting something hard, like Kate's helm, if you strike as hard as you can, the first thing that's going to break is your sword, not her helm. So again, people who say, oh, historical fighting, you have to hit really, really hard. No, they couldn't, because it'd break their sword, which is a major problem when you're fighting with that sword.
Ring finger, knuckles coming.
Let me see.
You weren't using that finger.
Yeah, I wasn't. Okay. So, stand, you ready? Lay on. Okay.
You okay?
Yeah, good. Get out of the way,
Scott. David, quit trying to help. People in full armor can get up just fine as long as nobody gets in their way and tries to help.
My bad.
Oh, dirt in the eye?
Yep. In the bottom of the helm.
Sand inside your helm is unpleasant.
Hold. Replace David's sword.
Why am I replacing?
That tip is getting
pretty. That tip is getting pretty scary.
Oh.
Yeah. No point in shattering the tip.
What?
Okay. No, I'm more worried about the sword. You got ribs, you'll heal. You're young.
Thanks. You got backups.
Okay, play on.
Good.
Right in the hand? Yep, right in the palm. If you don't think that would stop you fighting, think again. One each.
Yes, good.
Where? Oh, okay, throw. Couldn't see it. Two on Kate, one on David.
Oh, yes, good. Wow.
I think that's three on Kate. And then, okay, so that one went inside the cuirass, right here. So yes, that inside the cuirass with a good thrust would have definitely been a good blow. So this fight is going to be between Patrick and Scott.
There's all of them on fixed.
Stand, you ready?
I wasn't planning to take you down.
Lay on.
You didn't leave me much choice, I'm afraid.
I don't know where it is. Armpit? Oh, elbow. So, Scott got his point into Patrick's elbow. One each. Two on Pat. One on Scott. He said, oh yeah, I felt that.
Can I help?
That might be worth one and a half.
What's that? Oh, he thinks that one was actually worth one and a half.
Good.
Good job. It's all a shot. That part's not so armored either, Patrick.
That was not my intended target.
Two each.
My plane.
Oh, that's a perfectly legitimate horn. Historical attack and went right into Scott's groin. Totally legitimate spot. Yep. Ouch.
Them a lot better than they
can. No, they both said no. Not that hard. Has anybody yielded yet?
Oh hell!
Still alive in there?
Okay. That one went to. That one went to.
What?
Okay. So the reality is, they both said, "Really? Nobody had the advantage for all of that. We were both lying on the ground. Nobody had the advantage. So there's no point in that little engagement." I think the ground one. Yeah. No, Patrick, you're supposed to hold it. There you go. There you go. Where's our friend who's keeping score? What was the score again?
2-2.
2-2, okay. All right, lay on. So Patrick said, I felt something, and Scott, because he was moving while he was throwing it, there just wasn't enough leverage, so he said, no good. But you saw him try to get Patrick's knee. Nope, that was on the armor. That was on the armor. That was right on the head. Good fight, gentlemen. Enjoy, because really it's very rare to be able to see real historical techniques like this that end up on the ground. It takes a tremendous amount of trust in your opponent. It takes a lot of training together to be safe in being able to take each other to the ground. This was worked on over a period of 2 or 3 years of them learning how to do this safely. Okay, so Richard and Harvey, that's okay?
We're fine. The question is, are we stepping
on
anybody else?
Okay, so our unarmored folks are going to come back on the field. I think our armored folks may be done an hour of fighting in 50 pounds of armor against and wrestling on the ground. It's a serious workout. The unarmored is also amazingly a pretty serious workout as well. You're not moving quite so much armor around, but you might notice that you're moving the swords a lot more. So if Harvey would show us, say, ox, yes, going ox and his verge, you spend a whole lot of time up there pushing against each other's blades, and you'd be amazed. There's funny little muscles up here in the shoulders that just nothing else works the way this works.
The weirdest request.
I fell down.
Now there are divots in the ground, courtesy of all the armor. Yes. Okay. So, gentlemen, stand you ready? Lay on. Harvey got a nice cut into Richard's face. Okay. One each.
You have any questions?
My mom.
Bring
it on.
So another second hit on Richard's arm. So two on Richard, one on Harvey.
I know some because we've seen him. You want to go see that one?
Are they okay, third hit on Richard's arm. Good fight, gentlemen. Okay, so Adam is stepping in.
He'll put his hat on in a minute.
You put the hat on?
You put the hat on. Just take some
of okay, cut on Harvey's arm. Nice call. Cut on Adam's arm.
And a slice.
Okay, they exchange slices on the arms that time. So two on Harvey, one on Adam. One, two each. I think you're trading blows. Okay, gentlemen. Take a deep breath. Oh, we're starting over. Let's try this again. Not surprisingly. Okay, cut on Adam. Not surprisingly, when you start to get tired, the first thing that happens is it's harder and harder to understand you have to do defense and offense too on Adam at the same time. Every position has to involve defense as well as offense. The tireder you are, the harder it is to do both at the same time. And double hits. Ah, nice one to Harvey. So it's two on Adam, one on Harvey. If the harder it is to maintain the focus, to make sure every movement is both at the same time.
Back of the fencing mask. Much advice.
Bye-bye.
Three on Harvey, definitely got his leg, but I think that was three on you, right? Yes, but that was, Adam lost his leg doing it. Okay, gentlemen, nice fight.
You and Dave are
okay, so we're going to come
Patrick.
Out, introduce all our fighters one more time, explain who we are, then some of us are going to keep fighting just because it's fun. So if you're enjoying this, feel free to stick around. We'll be doing some more fighting because this is what we do for fun. Again, we are Chivalry Today. If anyone's interested, we have a website, chivalrytoday.com. This is Scott Farrell, who is the head and our trainer. This is Aaron. This is Kate. Harvey. Adam. Richard. David, who came down from San Jose. We lost him to work up there. We're happy he's down. Patrick, who came down also from the Bay Area. We're so glad he came down to visit. And I'm April. I'm Scott's wife. So we, as I said before, we offer lessons in historical fighting techniques, both in Sorrento Valley at Team Touche Fencing and in East County at Lionheart Fencing. So if anybody thinks this looks like fun, and believe me, it is fun, the lessons we offer are the unarmored lessons, okay? So look us up. There's a lot of interesting articles on the website also about historical and chivalric issues. So thank you very much. one more time, and we're going to stick around and fight. Again, feel free to come up, ask questions, look at the armor, watch the fighting. Glad to see you up here.
It's very sweaty.
Oh, yeah.
We apologize.
But it's okay. Same with pretty much everything. I'm wearing a jacket underneath everything.
Oh, yeah.
That will keep things from pinching. A little bit of padding. 3 pounds. So you're not wearing a lot of padding.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah,
finesse.
Yes.
And these things, what are they? Actually, those are armpits.
I don't have this here. This is a nice target. This is not a great way to cover it. But it's something. That, this is actually the best part you've got. I'm facing another person my size.
Yeah.
Going down to the knee. Getting it in the neck is hard because people can drop their chin and drop their visor down and protect it or move. But this is hard to protect. So adding a little extra something that might catch the edge of a sword and stop it is the purpose.
Which is why the guy, Scott, really can't stop it. This stuff is pretty.
It's metal.
But that is metal, so it's a layer of canvas.
These are all rivets.
Oh, okay.
A metal plate.
Oh,
okay.
Oh, I see.
Okay. In a minute, can you stand?
So, this is done in leather. He's wearing the same thing. It's an earlier period of last season.
If to the British Islands, its origins are lost in the mists of the Middle Ages, and it is known as Morris dancing. Morris dancing is a tradition that began in the southwest of England, but has now infected the entire world, even here in the distant seaside village of San Diego. We are the Moreton Bay Fig Morris Dancers. We had our origin right here in Balboa Park. We're named after the Moreton Bay Fig Tree here in Balboa Park. And we're going to be giving you an exhibition of what this form of British folk dance is all about. Each dance is based in a particular village, and we're going to perform a dance now from a village that is in the west of England in the border area with Wales. It is a very small village known as Much Winlock, to distinguish it from the even smaller Less Winlock. And so here we go with the Much Winlock stick dance.
Now you
can go by yourself.
Thank you.
It's customary. That's not customary. It's customary in Morris circles to do dances with props. The previous dance was a stick dance. Now, in the old days, people would go out into the woods and cut sticks off trees. These days, at least here in town, we go down to Home Depot and get sledgehammer handles. So that's what we're actually using. As you can imagine, it requires a little bit of training to dance while you're clashing sledgehammer handles together. But that's far from the most dangerous prop we use. Even more dangerous are the razor sharp hankies. Do not attempt this without training. Do not try this at home, kids. We're going to do a dance now that's native to San Diego. We wrote it, nobody else does it in the entire world. And its name reflects the way we sometimes feel after practice, muddled. Of England Fete, we're doing something, our group is doing something that's very traditional for village fetes. If you were to attend a village fete anywhere in England, you would stand a very good chance of having the local Morris team or Morris side perform at a village fete, often on the grass, in fact. It's one of the few forms of dance that's often done on the grass, but it also helps if you have a solid, even surface to avoid twisting your ankle. So we're kind of fans of the non-ankle twisting bit. If you have seen much British television, you've probably heard of an obscure little show called Doctor Who, right? How many people here have heard of Doctor Who? Very good. It's actually not so obscure. Yes, I see you're a fan of the Tom Baker era. Well, Tom Baker's predecessor as Doctor Who was a gentleman named John Pertwee. He was the third Doctor, and he actually took part in a Morris dance. In one of the episodes, he was in a sleepy English village and became embroiled in a Morris dance, and he said he would have loved to stay, but he had to save the world, or something like that. Well, it so happens the dance that he was performing in that episode with the Morris dancers was called Young Collins. And so, in honor of Doctor Who, we're now going to perform that same Morris dance. Ladies and gentlemen, Young Collins. To work and let them do the dancing. You want to see that? Dancing and playing at the same time. Put your hands together, ladies and gentlemen, for the one, the only Fiddler's Jig.
I'm looking at him. Why over here? And then we got one in the
Ladies and gentlemen, Fiddler's Jig, another dance not done anywhere else. Now, one of the things you may wonder is where do Morris dancers get their impeccable fashion sense? Well, every team, and they're called teams, they're also called sides, but every dance group has its own uniform, and this is ours. Among the common elements in a Morris dancer's uniform are bells. So Morris dancers literally are there with bells on. In fact, that may be related to the origin of the phrase. It's not quite clear. But in any event, we jingle while we dance. They're also very colorful. They have ribbons. A lot of spring colors in many Morris dancers' uniforms. And it's an activity that's a lot of fun. And we do it every week here in Balboa Park. We don't wear the costumes when we practice. We just wear ordinary clothes. And we do it every week on Tuesday nights in the Moore Memorial Building. And if you care to come and try it out, you'd be most welcome. Our team has two strict rules. Number one, you must have a pulse. Number two, you must be a primate. So if you meet those two very stringent requirements, we'd love to have you come out and join us and try it and see if you like it. It's a lot of fun. Also, it's very common for the team after we've danced to go out to the pub for refreshment afterwards. So there's camaraderie and conviviality involved. We dance from 7:30 to 9 on Tuesday evenings. We also have a website you can visit. It's sandiegomorris.com. So it's very easy to find and remember, just sandiegomorris.com. Now, Morris dancing is rooted in tradition, and I'm sure many of you have heard of the book by the famous French novelist Alexandre Dumas, The Three Musketeers, right? That's where they use swords, even though they're called musketeers. You'd think that they would use muskets. And I guess maybe they do, but they're famous for using swords. And one of the things that often happens in Morris dance, stick dances, is the use of the sticks can mimic sword play. And this next dance is an example of that. We have taken the concept of the three musketeers, and actually if you read the novel, you'll find out there's a fourth musketeer, who I guess his agent wasn't as good, he didn't get title billing. But there's a fourth musketeer, and so we do this dance with four dancers, and it's known as the Four Musketeers. Sometimes after dark, you'll note the sword play element with the sticks. Sometimes after dark, we even do it with lightsabers. Yeah.
All right, thank you.
And you thought the Chivalry Today folks had a monopoly on swordplay.
The bridge on right there.
There we go. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to do our last dance of this performance. It is a thorny little dance known as the Rose Tree. And you will notice we're using a prop that we haven't used thus far. So far today, we've used the long sledgehammer handles, and we've used the razor-sharp hankies. Now we're going to use short sticks, sledgehammer handles that have been cut in half. This means that your knuckles get closer to the other guy's stick. So, ladies and gentlemen, cross your fingers for the Rose Tree. Village Fete. We hope you'll take the opportunity to learn more about this wonderful activity. The way to do that is to go to San Diego Morris morris.com. Once again, it's sandiegomorris.com, and coming down to Balboa Park, you've already proven you can get here, and visit us on Tuesday nights. It's a lot of fun. Till we meet again, we are Moreton Bay Fig Morris.
I was playing.
Thank you all so much for coming out today, and thank you to our exhibitors for showcasing all your amazing talents. Just a reminder, we still have sausage rolls and sandwiches for sale at the booth over there, as well as the baked goods inside. Thank you so much.
She was trying to tell me Montana. More cannabis?
Yeah, that's one thing about books.